The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
Hi, I'm Annie Koshy, and I'm glad that you've joined me for In Focus with Annie J Koshy, where I look at people and their milestones, places where international change makers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. You can tune in on Saturdays at 4 p.m. to News Talk Saga 960 AM. Follow Saga 960 AM on Instagram and on Facebook, and you can follow me as well on Instagram under Annie J Koshy or under GTA South Asian Media Network. If there was a common theme in conversations with real estate companies, agents last year, it was about uncertainty. There were differing views on several important issues ranging from suburbanization to long-term shifts in office vacancies due to remote working to really the outlook on how Canada was going to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic. Another theme that was consistent across much of the industry was the accelerated pace of change that was happening. Now, with me today, I have got a very dear friend of mine. Tony Ning is a broker with over 30 plus years of experience in all facets of real estate. Especially, we're going to talk about the hot GTA market and the upcoming trends for spring and summer of 2021. Welcome to the show, Tony.
Thank you, Annie. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you here. Now, let's begin with, first off, your incredible achievements that really began at the age of 18. And I believe that it was at 18 that you purchased your first home. Most of us at the age of 18 are trying to figure out how to get into universities. There you were doing real estate investment at such a young age. What brought you to that moment?
Well, you know, I'm an immigrant. Came here when I was 7 years old, and my mom is a single mom. She had four kids, and I was the youngest of the four. So we rented, like, you know, when we first came here, we were living on the third floor, five of us in a little cubbyhole of the third floor, and we were being evicted all over the place. So one day my mom, well, not one day, but many days, she would say, all I want is a house. All I want is to own a house. And at 14 years old, I picked up this book called Think and Grow Rich.
I know that book.
I know, Napoleon Hill. And I thought, I can think. If I can think, I can grow rich, right? And it was on sale. So I picked it up. I read it back and forwards. And I tried to figure out, how can I help my mom get a house?
Right.
So at 15, I started working. I started working summer during school break and also on weekends. And I worked so much that I was able to save up I'm giving away my age now, right? I saved up $5,000. And my mom also saved up $5,000. So we had $10,000. The house was $50,000. Okay, so we put $10,000 against $50,000. And the problem was we couldn't qualify for the mortgage because my mom was working at these, immigrant type of jobs where they don't pay a lot of money. And I was going to school. I was full-time in school. And so I went to the bank manager and I said, look, how can I qualify for a mortgage? And she says, quit school. You go full-time working and you can get a mortgage. So I went back to my mom and talked to her about it. And she said, no, that's not an option. You have to finish your school. So we went back to the seller and said, listen, we got turned down by the bank. How can we buy this house? And through some negotiating, I said, we'll give you full price. We won't negotiate price. And whatever money you're going to take out of the house and put in bank, we will double or even triple that in interest rates. So we offered them 11% interest rate, which was a lot of money at that time. And they took the deal, right? So at 18, I was able to buy a house without bank financing.
It was, that is incredible. But that led you to buying and selling over 60 homes personally, and right. You found that it was creating a huge profit for you. How did that happen?
Well, you know, after buying that home, I realized that the price had gone up. I said, this is pretty good. Mm-hmm. Right. So, and I saw other people buying homes and fixing them and flipping them and making a lot of money. So that's when I thought to myself, why don't I do that too? So that's how I got into it. I started buying homes. First home I bought was $65,000. and we fixed it up and we flipped it for $79,000. And then it just grew from there. And then we bought another home for $159,000 and we sold for $284,000 within 3-4 months. So it just, you know, it just perpetuated from there. So yeah, it was something that I really think I believed in, the real estate market. And it was something that worked out well for me.
Well, Tony expanded his reach by becoming a licensed in order to be able to research more deals as well as help other investors with their investment portfolio as well. Right. Tony's exponential growth led him to becoming a broker of record in both real estate as well as mortgages, serving clients in residential, pre-constructions, investment, and commercial real estate. Well, Tony, that's quite a lot that you were able to do. What was the challenge for you to actually get the licensing? Let's start with that.
Getting licensing in real estate wasn't that difficult. It was just, at that time it was... 6 courses that we had to take, and also taking a broker's course, that's additional courses and mortgage. You know, it's a lot of studying. There's a lot of, you know, I mean, it's no different than going to university for any type of subject that matter that you wanted, that you're interested in. So yeah, it was a necessity. I needed those licenses to help me perpetuate my real estate goals and also to help other people. That was, you know.
Is there a area that you are absolutely passionate about out of the areas that you have a focus in? So whether it's residential, pre-construction, in investment, or in commercial real estate, is there one particular area that you are truly passionate about that you're mainly focused on?
My passion, ever since I was very young, was creating passive income. Passive income is really the key. I mean, you can make millions of dollars and you could spend millions of dollars, but passive income, having $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 come in month after month passively, is to me is really the wealth building module or model that I like to focus on. So investment properties that have passive income is great. Any type of passive income generating strategies, I try to specialize in those. And all real estate has some components of that, you know, if you look hard enough.
Was that difficult to sustain during last year, though?
I had a lot of clients that had difficulties with tenants because of COVID. A lot of tenants had lost their job and wasn't able to pay. So yeah, there was some difficulties, but I'm happy to say that since I would say February of this year, a lot of that has cleared up and the market has just taken off like crazy. So I have some of these investors that decided to sell and cash out because the market is so good. And I have other investors that are looking to buy into it right now because, you know, it's just a good market to get into because prices are going up so fast. They can turn around and make a profit very quickly.
We're going to come back after this break, Tony, because that's exactly what I want to talk about. Canada's real estate market is too hot to handle, they're saying. And a lot of people from outside of Canada is saying that it's just a bubble waiting to be burst. But we've been talking about this bubble bursting for several years now. And we seem to be somehow coasting through it all. We're going to take a short break right now. You've been tuned into InFocus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. And I'm here with Tony Ning, who's going to be talking about the real estate trends that are happening for spring, summer, and fall here in 2021 after the huge pandemic hit that market last year. Stay tuned. We've got lots to cover in this today's show.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
I'm glad that you've joined me for In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, where I look at people and their milestones, places where international changemakers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. Now, Tony has helped many investors build wealth through real estate over the years, and he recently founded the Real Estate Mastery Group, which offers training, mentoring, and motivational public speaking engagements on the topic of how to succeed in life and real estate investment. Now, Tony had bought a very large home off of Mississauga Road and was semi-retired when something completely changed his life. Tony, welcome back to the show. Let's talk about that time an extended period of time in your life that was quite dark.
Well, you know, I was actually attending my father-in-law's birthday party at the time, and I got a call on my phone, and it was the police officer saying that your mom is standing in the rain, wandering around, not knowing where she was. That's when I went to pick her up, and my life changed after that. She has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and for the next 10 years, I spent time looking after her, full-time looking after her, and making sure that she was okay. So that was when they discovered that my income was limited in the sense that you can spend it no matter how much you have. And having passive income was really, really important.
Yeah, it was because when you did stop working to take care of your mom full time, it meant that you were living off of your savings and what you had thought was going to sustain and last you ended up being something that you were eating into, and mm-hmm. there was nothing filling that coffer again. And so, and of course, it was a time that you were emotionally pulled in two different directions, because this was the same, you know, this was your mom that had sacrificed all of her, you know, life and whatever for you and your siblings. Yes. And therefore, there was no question in your mind as to whether you were going to take this time to help her. But I think what was really glaringly obvious during this period was how important it was to not only earn that passive income for yourself, but also teach others how to earn passive income so that they're able to sustain themselves. Now, this lasted for a period of 10 years, and you faced a lot of financial devastation during this time. What was one of the most significant lessons that led to a change that has led you to actually go into the coaching and changing lives now?
Well, I created a passion for passive income for myself. And when I look around at how people, well, especially in the COVID pandemic, where people have lost their jobs, and, you know, I'm looking at news and CNN and all these other news channels, and people are actually going on without food, you know, for the children. It's horrible, right? So I'm very passionate to get myself out of that dark days of not having passive income. I've created passive income now, and I want to help others, you know, achieve the same. And it's not as difficult as you think it is. There are a lot of different vehicles that you could use to do that. And I'm here to help anyone that wants to be helped.
And so let's speak about Canada's housing market has been considered to be too hot to handle. That's how it's been looked at. There, people on the outside looking in say that it's a bubble just waiting to be burst. And it continues to grow despite, you know, sort of hesitation or despite a wariness that this bubble is about to burst. Vancouver especially and Toronto's real estate markets continue to lead Canadian cities in terms of investment, development prospects. Now, every region has its own opportunities and challenges. We're going to focus on Ontario.
Sure.
What are some of the trends that you're seeing happening that are a stark difference from what happened last year?
Well, what happened last year was a lot of people did not want to participate in selling or even buying real estate. So because of the COVID, because it was difficult to have showings, open houses were banned, offices were closed. So there's a lot of things that that shifted the mindset of people. Now this year, what's different is that a lot of people that wanted to buy last year is now ready to come out and buy this year because the vaccination is available now. And a lot of people that were afraid to sell are selling now, but still there's not enough inventory out there. So there's more buyers than there are sellers. And therefore these buyers are trying to grab anything they can. Now the trend is more for the freehold homes, like the detached semis and freehold townhomes, because a lot of people, because they've been cooped up in their apartment so long, they want to live, a lot of them want to move into a house and have a nice house to live in, right? And a lot of people are moving out of the city. They want to move out of Toronto and move into the suburbs, further out, smaller cities around Ontario, and even into cottage country. That's booming right now.
Now, for first-time homeowners, it can be difficult to decide when is the right time to buy property given this uncertainty. Now, many would have thought that during COVID, it would have been a more easier market because people would be able to find places. But actually, it's been the reverse. It's actually been a seller's market and not a buyer's market.
Right. The reason is because we don't have a lot of inventory. There's not enough sellers compared to how many buyers there are. And also the interest rates are so low. People want to get in. Like right now, the 5-year interest rate is 1.8%. It's phenomenally low. So people that want to get in, want to get in and lock it in for 5 years. So they have a place to live that they know they're going to own, and they're able to afford it over the next 5 to 10 years.
Now, that's quite interesting because despite higher unemployment and more uncertainty, there's still a high level of demand for purchasing a home.
Yeah, because, you know, there's two necessities of life, and that is food and shelter, right? So when you're not traveling anymore, when you're not spending money on vacations and all the other stuff, where are you going to spend your money? On food and shelter, right? So I think that's the reason why it is. And also because the pandemic has forced people to have home offices and work from home. So they want to have a nice home to work from.
So is the trend continuing to be moving to a more urban location, or are people shifting to a more suburban lifestyle?
Was urban, suburban. I mean, they're moving into smaller cities. Like Windsor's really hot, London. You name a city and it's doing extremely well. Like cities like Hamilton that wasn't doing very well at one time many, many years ago are doing phenomenal. Oshawa's doing phenomenal. All the cities that I can think of are doing phenomenal in Ontario. And the reason why is that because in the U.S., if you were immigrating to the U.S. or migrating to U.S., you have so many cities to select from. In Canada, you got Toronto, Vancouver, maybe Montreal, maybe Calgary. There's not that many to choose from. And really, Toronto and Vancouver, in my opinion, are the real two big cities that people choose. And the reason why Canada is so favored over a lot of cities in the U.S. is because we got a friendly government. Our multicultural tolerance is a lot better in Canada. And also, we have healthcare. We got education. And we got people here that really love being in Canada. Simply because we have a really good infrastructure.
Now, millennials, are they, and many of them trying to purchase their first property, do they have a preferred type of property that they're going into? Do they prefer more of a semi-detached? Are they looking more into investing a single, unit home? Or are they looking into still moving into that condominium market, which was very, very hot in 2019, saw a huge cooling in 2020? And what's the trend for 2021 in that?
Yeah, well, my view is that a lot of millennials, especially the ones that can work from home, are moving out of the city. They're going to Niagara Falls, they're going to Windsor, they're going to London, they're going to all different cities and even up north, they're going up to, I've got people going up to Sudbury, all the smaller cities that are a lot lower priced in accommodation, that's where they're going. And they're working from home, so they don't really have to travel to an office anymore. And a lot of them, believe it or not, I'm moving home to mom and dad. Mom and dad's buying a bigger home and they're giving up their $2,000-$3,000 condominium downtown and they're moving home with mom and dad, So I think the trend is for them to buy something. They prefer detached, don't get me wrong, but they'll settle for a semi or a freehold townhome, whatever's affordable. But if they could afford something like a detached, a little bit further away from Toronto, that's what their preference is.
Now, what is the struggle like for those in the rental market? Because that was something that is also really facing a lot of problems. Last year, the rent price for a single room or single bedroom place downtown Toronto ranged up from $2,000 and above. We're seeing a falling trend in that. Is it affordable at the current rate for immigrants and for those who are new entry to Canada, or those who have been devastated by the pandemic and the unemployment that it's been associated? Has our rental market cooled down a little bit?
Yes, the rental market has cooled down a little bit because a lot of investors are like Airbnb investors. They are getting hit very hard. short-term investors are getting very hard. So they're getting out of the rental market. And when they get out of the rental market, there's going to be a lot more properties that are not going to be rented out. So you have more, a glut of rental apartments coming on the market. I have a couple of rental units right now for rent, and it's been sitting on the market for over a month now and not getting any tenants. Usually last year at this time, or before COVID, when you had a rental unit, you had like two or three offers like almost immediately. So yeah, the rental market has softened a little bit. And a lot of people, like I said, the millennials, they're giving up the rental condominium and moving home. So you're getting a lot more rental units on the market right now. So there's more supply than there's demand.
Okay, so let's speak specifically about our GTA area. What is, in terms of focus areas, what's the hottest area that's going in the market right now, right from ground grassroots? You're out there, you know it right now. Where are the trends happening? Where are people really focusing in on right now?
I would have to say almost every pocket is hot right now. There's no cool. I mean, whether it's Brampton, Mississauga, downtown Toronto, Oshawa. I was in Oshawa the other day. They're getting multiple offers like crazy out there. I don't see a really calm market in the Toronto, greater Toronto area. Yeah. And also you have to remember, Toronto is a great city for immigrants. And right now we are not able to service the immigrants because of COVID. But once we open the doors again, a lot of immigrants will be coming to Toronto. And Toronto is considered like the major city in Canada, right? We got the Toronto Raptors, we got the basketball team, we got the Blue Jays, and we got the baseball team. We got all these famous U.S. Franchises in Toronto. And the reason why is because Toronto is, in my opinion, the center of Canada. So if you want to go to Canada, Toronto is it, in my opinion.
Well, according to the Canadian Real Estate Association, property sales in Canada increased 7.2% from November to December 2020. And for this fifth straight month, national sales remain at an all-time high. So it's safe to say, Tony, I agree with you, that the Canadian real estate market is booming despite COVID-19 and the ongoing issues with the pandemic. Now, Canada has seen a record year of property sales in 2020 with over 12% increase in transactions compared to 2019. And that is mind-boggling. You know, I am going to have to take a short break right now, but we're going to continue talking about this because just like the market is hot, today's topic is hot. And I've got Tony Ning with me today. He's an expert with over 30 years of experience in the real estate market as a broker. We're going to come back. We're going to continue to talk about the trends that are happening in the Canadian real estate market. Stay tuned right after this message.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to nFocus with Annie J Koshy, where I am in conversation with Tony Ning. In 2021, Tony teamed up with a very large real estate agency and superstar Christopher Invidiata to jointly build an empire agency of agent associates, each of them helping each other to build a passive income that Tony had mentioned in our last segment in real estate, but also to help them secure a lifestyle, retire comfortably, and also continue to do that for not just their own generation, but the future generations to come. Welcome back to the show, Tony.
Thank you, Annie. Thanks to be here.
Well, Tony, your passion and mission is to help not only licensed agents, but really anyone learn and earn that passive income through passive income generation strategies. And mm-hmm. I love that you have that acronym and you used it earlier. And it's called PIGS. So right. That's great. But I do have another acronym I want to ask you about, and that is, what is WAM? How do you WAM someone?
Well, WAM is an acronym I put together to help me remember what it is that's important to succeed in life. And the W stands for why. You need to know your why. You need to know what, when, and where. Okay. So where means, are you going to do it locally in Mississauga or Toronto? Are you going to do it on the internet? So where are you going to execute your strategy? The H is how. How are you going to do it, right? And then the A is action. You have to take a lot of action. If the W and H without the A or action doesn't go anywhere. And then the final one is M. You need a mentor. I don't really think you can succeed in life to the point of where you want to be without a mentor. Let's face it, a mentor is very important. So that's my WHAM formula. So if anybody wants to expand on that, reach out to me. I'd be more than happy to go into each one in more detail.
Now, this helps your students to actually leap into the secrets of becoming financially independent. Tony, you are very motivated and driven to leave that legacy behind in order to show the world that anyone, really, I'm coming from an immigrant family myself, but mainly anyone who has that story of you've done it, rags to riches, sort of, that you can do. And you're trying to, or you're helping people replicate what you've done in their lives.
Right. I think understanding what it is, the fundamentals and the technicalities of what it needs or what you need to do in order to succeed in life is really important. You know, and not knowing the formula or the strategies is what's holding a lot of people back.
Okay, so let's jump right back into a couple of areas. How can someone assess whether their home meets their actual needs?
How do they? Well, you know, first of all, you have to find out how much you can afford, right? How much down payment do you have? How much can you qualify for? What is your credit rating to help you afford that mortgage? And then once you determine that, then you have to figure out where it is that you can buy that particular home that you really enjoy. For instance, if you want to buy a home for $500,000 and you want to detach, right? Toronto's not going to be it. You're going to have to find some other market where you can buy that for $500,000. For instance, Windsor's a great market for that. You can buy a beautiful home for $500,000 in Windsor. So once you know what it is, how much you can afford, then now you have to decide what it is that you want to What are you comfortable with? Do you want a detached home? Do you want a semi-detached home? Do you want a townhome? Now, if you want a townhome, perhaps something a little bit closer to Toronto is possible, right? For instance, you could go to maybe Niagara Falls and get a townhome for $500,000. So it really depends on what it is that you're looking for, what it is that makes you comfortable and happy, and then figure out how much you have to, how much you can you afford that particular lifestyle.
Now, there were a lot of individuals who had one home and then they had a number of other properties that they had invested in. The government's really hitting hard on those homeowners because they realize that there is a shortage of affordable housing, safe housing, regulated housing for people who need it, and a lot of people who are sitting on these empty homes. What's changed?
Well, the government was trying to impose a tax on people that own homes that are vacant. I mean, really, when you think about it, it's not a very smart thing to do. I mean, why would you want to hold it vacant? I mean, they're looking for a quick appreciation on a home. They buy it and they just hold on to it and then they flip it when the prices go up. That's not really a good model for investing. I mean, one should always think about the community. So when you invest in a property, you should provide housing to people that need housing. And you should create a win-win situation. That's my belief anyways. But yeah, there's a lot of investors that do that and the government is coming down on them for doing that.
Now, there was also so we're finding in the city of Toronto right now a lot of condos that are empty with the rising trend of a lot of companies going digital and working from remote locations. The market for office space has changed.
Right.
And it's leading to a lot of businesses not requiring the overheads that they would normally have put in to house that many staff. How is that changing in terms of space downtown?
Well, obviously, there's going to be more availability of office space. Some offices that I know of have converted to residential, and you're going to start seeing a lot more co-working space, where people use spaces on a part-time basis as opposed to a full-time basis. It'd be office shared type of environment. So, where it's going to go, I don't know. But once the vaccination and the pandemic is over, I think you're going to see a lot of people wanting to return back to an office again, because a lot of people just can't work from home.
Now, what is the, because one of the other areas that's been really impacting the market has been the loss of income for a lot of people. With the landlord and tenancy board closed at the moment, and a lot of backlog with cases, is it, what's the situation for renters in today's market?
It's tough. It's tough for renters because a lot of landlords are very careful now. They, you know, I represent a lot of landlords, and they want tenants that are working, and they want tenants with good credit rating, and they really want tenants that are in that are pretty much secure in their job. So they're afraid of putting a tenant into a unit and finding out that they can't afford to pay it 2 months later. So it's really tough, and the screening process has gotten very, very critical for a lot of landlords right now. So they're not letting our tenants just rent from them without doing forensic checking on the tenants, you know, to be honest.
And one more area that I want to focus on has been this rising trend as of late that homes in cottage country have seen an increase in price. Yeah. What's happening? What's that trend about?
Well, the trend is basically people just want to enjoy their life a little bit more. I mean, especially people in the, you know, the baby boomers, you know, they made their money downtown Toronto, they sell the house for $2 million and they go into cottage country and enjoy the rest of their life. They could buy something a lot cheaper in the cottage country and buy the lake, and they got the, you know, all the privacy that they want and all the land that they like, and, you know, and the lifestyle that they're looking for. And because there's so many people doing it, it's going up in price.
You know, that's quite interesting. We're going to see this trend happening where people are looking to move to not just suburbs, the suburbs, but to look to moving to areas even further beyond what would be suburbia and into more rural places where that's going to have a huge impact on the infrastructures that's required in those cities as well. Many of those cities are not able to deal with the volume, the sheer volume of new housing that's going to happen there. It's it has an almost domino effect.
Right. Well, you know, it's a growth issue. So every city, it will go through that depending on what stage they're at. I know the people that are moving into rural areas where it's just the well water and you know, and septic tanks. So they're okay with that. They don't mind it. They just want the lifestyle, you know, they want to enjoy their life. People want to enjoy their life. After the pandemic, they realize how much they miss the enjoyment of life. So a lot of people can't vacation right now. So where are you going to put your money? Buy a cottage, buy a nice home, enjoy your life.
Now, there was this trend that was going on for many years, and it was investors who were investing in condos downtown in what was termed as shoebox condos. You know, they didn't really want to live in them. They weren't really planning on renting them out. And now there's a gluttony of them.
Right. Well, you have to understand pre-construction condominiums or pre-construction of any type of property is really land banking, right? People are putting their deposits down. They don't have mortgage to pay. They don't have property tax to pay. They don't have any tenant headaches. So this is land banking along with the developer. And once the developer in 2 or 3 or 4 years developed that condominium, now we've got a nice shiny object that's called a condominium, and it's worth more money now than it was when it was just a piece of land. So now what they invested in, say they bought it for, I can quote you some of my investors, they bought about 400,000 back about 4 years ago, and I just sold one of their condos for $900,000 just last week. So to give you an idea of how much you can make, you know, just land banking with the developer in a really, really hot market.
Now, the market was so hot that last week in Ottawa, one particular home was sold for over $400,000 or $500,000 above asking.
Yep.
How is this even possible? And is the government going to step in at some point and put a stop to this?
I don't think they can right now because of the pandemic. I think once the pandemic is under control and everything is going smoothly again, people back to work and, you know, people enjoying their life and paying taxes again, I think you're going to see the government stepping in and making some moderations to curb the acceleration a little bit. But at this point in time, I don't think they have the tools to do that.
Well, you've been listening to Tony Ning and myself, and we've been talking about the hot market here in Ontario, here in Canada, with regards to real estate, and really how the trends are going to be for the rest of this year in where things are heated up and continue to heat up, but also the changes that's been happening and things that people should, you know, steer clear of and also watch out for. So stay tuned. We have another segment that we're going to come back with. We're going to talk to Tony about where and what he's going to be doing in the next little bit, where you can catch him if he's speaking. Stay tuned. You're listening to InFocus on Saga 960, and I will be back right after this message.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J Koshy, and we're just wrapping up an amazing conversation with Tony Ning on Toronto's hot real estate market. Well, Tony, before I continue, I do want to ask you, where can people find you on social media? Where can they find more information if they have specific questions before we just wrap up our show today?
I think the easiest way is to go to my website, which is www.tonyning.com. That's Tony, T-O-N-Y, and Ning is spelled N-I-N-G. That's N like November, I-N-G, at gmail.com. I mean, .com. www.brokertony.
Let's try that again. No, bro, no worries. So that's www.tonyning.com.
That's it, yeah.
Got it. That's okay. All right.
Sometimes you can say that for me. That might be easier.
Yeah, we need to go and sell a house right now. So that's great. So Tony, one of the things that you mentioned was about having a mentor. Sure. If someone is looking for a broker or a real estate mentor, what are some key areas that they should ask questions about or they should look for in a great mentor?
I think a great mentor should be someone that has done it, you know, a great mentor should have experience, should have the knowledge, and should have basically done what they're teaching you to do. Simply because I don't care how good the person is, they made some mistakes and you can learn from the mistakes. And they made some great, great investments and you can learn from those as well. So someone that is in the trenches, that knows what they're doing and has done it many, many times, I think that's what you should look for. Those are the qualities in a mentor. And someone that can teach that to you.
That's brilliant. I think that that's important. And I like one of the things that you said there, Tony, and that is that they've made mistakes. And I think that you can learn from it. That's really, really important, is that some of the greatest learnings that you can actually take away are from the mistakes that you make in life. Right. And those teach you invaluable lessons and sometimes lessons that you will never forget. You right. know, they sort of gave it, you yeah. know, become engraved in your head. Well, right. that's great. That's important to understand specific things to look at when you're looking for a mentor. But what about specifically versus a broker versus a real estate agent versus an agency? What are some of the differences and who should they approach?
Well, a brokerage is somebody that's taken on the additional education to be able to open up their own franchise or open up their own agency. That's what a broker is. An agent is someone that has studied the course and became a sales representative, and they're qualified to do that. And an agency is basically a company where they have other agents working for them, and they usually have a manager, broker, or someone at a higher level coaching, mentoring, and helping them.
Well, Tony, I know I put you on the hot seat today. I know I really grilled you on some of those questions and made you really answer them because it's a hot topic today. Mm-hmm. I want to know if I've got someone listening right now and they have money to invest. They're getting back on their feet. They're looking into the investment. They're seeing that the markets are really hot right now and they want to get in before it keeps going up high. They're looking at what are some of the pitfalls that they should avoid?
Well, for one, you need to know your exit strategy. Why are you doing it? Okay. Are you buying it to flip, fix and flip? Or are you buying it to rent it out and hold on to it long term? What is your strategy? I think a lot of novice investors, the mistake they make is they buy the cheapest property out there. And the cheapest property is not always the best property out there. I call them dollar store properties, right? You go there and then you find out it's a money pit. You got to fix this, you got to fix that. And by the time you're done, you are not making any money, right? I prefer to buy a property that is in really good shape. It's got really good bones. I just have to put some lipstick on it and make it look really pretty and sell it to an end user that wants to move into it and enjoy the property. So those are some of the things that you should look for if you're looking for flipping. If you're looking for buying to... And also the demographics, that's really important, right? If you're selling to an end user, you're gonna sell it for more money than you would selling to an investor. If you're selling to an investor, then you should be buying in the neighborhood where there's a lot of tenants, because tenants are the customers for that property. So you need to know the demographics. You need to know what you're going after, what your strategy is, and what your exit strategy is. It's really important. There's a lot more that I can explain in 2 minutes, but the essence of it is to know what you're doing and why you're doing it.
Well, there you have it. Are you interested in hearing more? I would suggest that you reach out to Tony Ning. He is extremely experienced with over 30 years of experience in the real estate market. He is a broker of record. And there you have it. In today's show, you've had the entire real estate market sort of summed up in terms of why it's so hot, how it's continuing to heat up, and what you can do if you're interested in getting a piece of that as well. Well, that's today's show. You can reach me at info@saga960am.ca, Attention Annie or the Ninja. If you've missed out on my live show today, you can tune in on Wednesday for a repeat of the show from 9 to 10 p.m. You can also tune in at our website at www.saga960am.ca, where there will be a podcast of this show as well as all of the other great shows. Stay safe.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.